The wilderness and the dry land shall rejoice. The desert shall blossom and burst into song. They shall see the glory of the Lord, the majesty of our God. Grace and peace to you from God, our Creator, the love at our beginning and without end, in our midst and with us. Friends, we have come to the first Sunday of Advent, the first Sunday of the new church year. That's when we are. We have come to this place of worship, here in the land of Mi'kma'ki, here in the presence of one another and in the eternal presence of God. That's where we are. With these entwined histories behind us, we hope for a bright future ahead of us. We endeavor to live as people of peace and friendship. And on this first Sunday of Advent, we endeavor to live as people of hope. Our service today begins with the lighting of the Advent candle wreath, and so I'll turn it over to the choir to lead us in song and to some choristers to lead us in the readings.
When hope hangs low in the human heart, you, loving Creator, kindle compassion, breathing life into the early embers of change and empathy.
We light a candle for hope, sending prayers high into the inky heavens and dreams deep into the human soul. God of all hope, as Advent dawns, shine your light on the story of the saints who journeyed before us. May the seeds they planted in the world, peace, joy, love, take hold in our hearts and stretch towards the light.
We light a candle for hope. May it light the way.
Now in your blue hymn book, you may turn to hymn number 114, Lo, He Comes, with clouds descending. Let us pray. God of timeless grace, you fill us with joyful expectation. Make us ready for the message that prepares the way so that with uprightness of heart and holy joy, we may eagerly await the coming of Christ, who reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the proclamation of the word.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles the brushwood and the fire causes the water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those gladly who do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like the one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. They all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind takes us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hands of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the works of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember our iniquities forever. Now consider, we are all your people. The word is the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm today is Psalm 80. Verses 1 to 7, 17 to 19. We will read it responsibly as indicated by the bold print. Hear, O shepherd of Israel, leading Joseph like a flock, shine forth, you that are enthroned upon the cherubim. In the presence of Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh, stir up the strength and come to help us. Restore us, O God of hosts, Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. O Lord God of hosts, how long have you angered despite the prayers of your people? You have fed them with the bread of tears. You have given them bowls of tears to drink. You have made us the derision of our neighbors, and our neighbors laugh us to scorn. Restore us, O God of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. Let your hand be upon the one tied in awe, the one you have made so strong for yourself. And so will we never turn away from you. Give us life, that we may call upon your name. Restore us, O Lord of hosts. Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The gradual hymn, Christ Be Our Light, is printed at the back of the bulletin.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the days of King Herod of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly order of Abijah. His wife was a descendant of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. Both of them were righteous before God, living blamelessly according to all the commandments and regulations of the Lord. But they had no children, because Elizabeth was barren and both were getting on in years. Once when he was serving as priest before God and his section was on duty, Zechariah was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to enter the sanctuary of the Lord and offer incense. Now, at the time of the incense offering, the whole assembly of the people was praying outside. Then there appeared to him an angel of the Lord, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was terrified, and fear overwhelmed him. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will name him John. You will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord." Zechariah said to the angel, "How will I know that this is so? For I am an old man, and my wife is getting on in years." The angel replied, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of the Lord, and I come to bring you this good news. But now, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time, you will become mute, unable to speak until the day these things occur." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondered at his delay in the sanctuary. When he did come out, he could not speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision in the sanctuary. He kept motioning to them and remained unable to speak. When his time of service was ended, he went to his home. After those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she remained in seclusion. She said, "This is what the Lord has done for me when he looked favorably on me and took away the disgrace I have endured among my people." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, we have entered into this season of Advent, this time of preparation, and in our home, it has been exactly that. We've learned over the years that if we wait too long to decorate, well, December just gets bonkers, and we might be in a real scramble in the end. So we've decided to start early this year. We've got the nutcrackers out, we've got the greens, they're hung, it's beautiful, it's really lovely to have this this time of beauty and preparation in our home. And in the church, similar things are happening. We've already had the festive annual bazaar. The choral practices are focusing on Christmas music now. We are writing a pageant for Christmas Eve. There is a sense of growing joy and anticipation. But in the church, another sort of preparation is happening too. We get ready for Christmas by reading some of the ancient prophetic writings from times and places when, quite frankly, all was not well. "Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down. These were the words that started our scripture reading today, words from the prophet Isaiah there in the 64th chapter of the book that takes his name. His situation was one of acute longing and lament. To give you a sense of the context there, the book of Isaiah covers quite a span of time. It documents the people's going away into exile, and then it anticipates their joyous return to the homeland. There's a sense that things are going to be good, you know, it'll be like the old times. But what happens in that third and final section of the book of Isaiah is that some of the people have returned, some of the people had remained the whole time, and there is no peace between them. There is no comfort there at home. The homeland is a desolation. There's conflict amongst the people, and there's no sense of a common identity, a common purpose, a common love. The prophet expresses that people are not at their best. The behaviors reflect the difficulty of the situation, and so no one is free of guilt. He describes how there's a sense of filth, a sense of waywardness amongst the people. And so there is this overwhelming unease that comes not only from the external circumstances, but from the worst impulses that are bubbling up from the hearts of the people. It's a fairly hopeless moment. And so the prophet cries out to God, "Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, that you would do again for us what you have done in the past, to restore us, to put us in the right direction, on the right path, in right relationship with one another and with you." So now, why would we recall a situation like that at this time in the church? Why do we make the prophets a part of our preparation for Christmas? Well, it's not to be obstinate. It's not to be killjoys or humbugs in a time of year that should be about joy. No. We turn to the prophets because we need annual seasons of lament and longing and reflection just as much as we need annual seasons of joy and celebration. In fact, these two have a distinct and deep relationship to each other. And anyone with eyes open and hearts open to the world today will know that we are in rough shape, much as the people in Isaiah's time were. There is discord, there is division, there is violence, there is desolation. And so these ancient words of Scripture, they don't seem so ancient. In fact, they give us language for our longing and our lament today. The words of Scripture also give us assurance of the promises that have been fulfilled over and over again throughout history, so that we have somewhere to go, some pattern to follow out of our longing, out of our lament, and towards true joy and hope. We heard also today the story of Zechariah in the temple, and of an angelic visitation, even from Gabriel, who we know will appear again in this season before Christmas, indicating a pattern that repeats. The story of Zechariah and Elizabeth is a story of longing on a human scale, at the scale of one couple longing for a child. In the temple, even in their old age, prayers for a child are the prayers that Elizabeth and Zechariah add to the chorus of the prayers of all the people who are gathered there. And in due time, God responds to them. Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God, assures Zechariah, "Your prayer has been heard." Well, it's almost too good to be true. There are echoes in this story of God's response in other times as well, as when God heard the prayers of Hannah, when she prayed and wept in the temple, and God blessed her with the conception and birth of her son Samuel. There are echoes also in the speechlessness of Zechariah that follows the angelic announcement. It almost recalls Sarah's laughter when she overhears the message of a birth that was made to her husband Abraham. Both Zechariah's silence and Sarah's laughter are, well, they're involuntary responses to the extraordinary news that a child will be born to people well beyond childbearing years. As we become familiar with the biblical stories and with their repeated motifs, the Christmas story of Jesus' birth fills out with a sense of memory as well as a sense of miracle. Some aspects of that nativity story remain extraordinary. All those angels are extraordinary. But our memory of these earlier stories comforts us in the knowledge that this is what God does. God responds. God responds to prayers and to longing, not only for the sake of a few individuals who, in their homes and personal lives, long for a certain kind of joy, but for the sake of the whole world. The children born to these are spiritual ancestors to Sarah and Abraham, to Hannah and Elkanah, to Zechariah and Elizabeth. These children grow up to teach and serve and lead the people. These children reveal more and more of God as they become who they were meant to be. And lest we think that that's still ancient biblical material and it stops there when we close the pages of those books, well, let's consider. Today, on this 3rd of December, we're right in between those days which mark St. Andrew and St. Nicholas, much later people in history to appear and to reveal something of God's presence in their lives to those around them. It happens again and again and again. One of the ways that God responds to the prayers of the people is to send amongst the people those who will help and heal and give joy. And so the close and often private longings of the storied people in the Bible and throughout history are united with the universal longings of the nations. Restore us, O God, show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved, prays the psalmist. Remember us and show us your face. And as an answer to prayer, God sends a child to Zechariah and Elizabeth, and he will grow up to be John the Baptist, who prepares the way. You, my child, shall be called the prophet of the highest. So sings his father at his birth. Restore us, O God. Remember us and show us your face. As an answer to this prayer, God sends a child to Mary and Joseph. And this child is destined for the falling and rising of many, to be a sign that will be opposed so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed. But I get ahead of us. We are early in Advent. We need this whole season to feel the longing and to offer the lament of a world that waits in darkness. So may our hearts be broken open by this season. Yet also may our hearts be lifted up by the promise of God who loves this world and who will do a new thing yet again, as God has done throughout all of history. With hearts broken open and hearts lifted up, may we be ready to welcome God among us at this new birth. Amen. Please rise. If you desire, I invite you to join in these ancient words of faith, the Nicene Creed. Together, let us say, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. For the prayers of the people, you're welcome to take a posture that is comfortable for you.
The first Sunday in Advent gives us the opportunity to center our thoughts on hope. We reflect on the hope and promise of our Savior's birth. Let us ask God to ready our hearts to receive the gift of his Son. Our response will be, Son of God, Prince of Peace, come, Lord Jesus, come. God of hope, we thank you for the gift of your Son. On that first Christmas, you gave us that gift of hope wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. Let your hope swell in our hearts and open our eyes to see that our hope comes from you alone. Make our hearts leap with joy and fill our mouths with songs of praise as we announce the glad tidings and welcome him into our midst. Son of God, Prince of Peace, come. Lord Jesus, come. In our cycle of prayer, we pray for the Church of North India United, along with the parishes of the Chignecto region, with Amherst and Parthrow Shore. We pray for the life of this parish and ask your blessing on Bishop Sandra, Reverend Nicole, and all clergy. Give them wisdom, understanding, and strength so that they may follow in the footsteps of your Son and become instruments of your divine grace. Son of God, Prince of Peace, come. Lord Jesus, come. Gracious God, we pray for the church, that all who follow Jesus will be filled with joy and hope at his coming. We pray for the world, that all your children will reach out to help each other in the joy and love of our Lord Jesus. We pray for all who serve our country in leadership roles, that they may be strengthened by your grace and guided by your wisdom. Son of God, Prince of Peace, come, Lord Jesus, come. With grateful hearts, we give thanks for the joy and anticipation of gathering with friends and family to celebrate the birth of your beloved Son, our Savior. Preserve with your loving care those who travel to be with loved ones. Protect them from danger on their journey and guide them safely home once again. Son of God, Prince of Peace, come, Lord Jesus, come. God of peace and justice, we pray for those in troubled parts of the world who are caught between the forces of violence and conflict. Protect those in peril and guide them to a place of safety. Soften the hearts of those who have taken up arms and direct them to choose the path to peace. Son of God, Prince of Peace, come, Lord Jesus, come. Keep us under the shadow of your mercy. Sustain and support the anxious, the lonely, and the forgotten, and be with those who are sick and those who care for them, that they find comfort and hope and experience the healing power of your grace, especially those as listed in our bulletin. Son of God, Prince of Peace, come, Lord Jesus, come. Merciful and compassionate God, we remember with loving hearts all who have passed from this life into your loving arms. Grant peace eternal, and may they find peace and joy among the communion of saints. Son of God, Prince of Peace, come, Lord Jesus, come. Lord God, we thank you for this time of joyful waiting. May this season fill our hearts with hope and make us living signs of your love in a world that hungers for your peace. Shine in our lives with hope and promise, and prepare our hearts to welcome him so that, like the angels who announced his birth, we too might greet his coming with joy. We ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who alone does wonders, who lifts up the lowly, who fills the hungry with good things. Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sin, trusting in the tender mercy of our God. Most merciful God, we confess to you before the whole company of heaven and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. Forgive us our sins, heal us by your Spirit, and raise us to new life in Christ. Amen. People of God, in Christ Jesus, God has looked with favor on you. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, your sins are forgiven. May God strengthen you anew to follow the way of peace. Amen. Amen. Please rise. Peace with yourself, peace with creation, peace with one another. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
We share a sign of peace with one another. Peace be with you. Mm. Our offertory hymn is on the back of your bulletin, Come You Hungry. God of love and power, your word stirs within us the expectation of the coming of your Son. Accept all we offer you this day and sustain us with your promise of eternal life. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with
you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, who in the fullness of time came among us in our flesh and opened to us the way of salvation. Now we watch for the day when he will come again in power and great triumph to judge this world. that we, without shame or fear, may rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, Lord our God, for the goodness and love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your children, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God of promise, you prepare a banquet for us in your kingdom.
Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be
to God.
Jesus, we deem it of the world.
The dawn draws near, and the world.
Please rise. God, for whom we wait, you have fed us with the bread of eternal life. Keep us ever watchful that we may be ready to stand before the Son of Man. We ask this in the name of Christ the Lord. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, may the God of hope be with us in our Advent journey to the stable and beyond. Be with us in our meeting and in our traveling together. Be with us in our worship, song, and prayer. And may the blessing of God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, rest upon you this day and evermore. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. There's a big week coming. We've got some fabulous events happening here and in the wider community. So starting tonight is the annual service of lessons and carols at Manning Memorial Chapel. That's at 7 o'clock, of course, open to all. The other thing happening this evening is at 7:30 here. I don't think you can do both, but anyway, at 7:30 here, the Wolfville Historical Society is doing some readings from John Herbin, and so that's happening here in the main space. And again, all are welcome to that. The mini-series of the Emmaus sessions kicks off this Tuesday and Wednesday. It's the same session offered twice, Tuesday evening, Wednesday morning, and there will be three of those through this short season of Advent, each focusing on a well-known piece of music that will be the springboard for conversation. If you've been part of these small groups before, you know that any insights, questions, queries, stories are welcome, and that when they come together, there really is a sparkling conversation that happens. So please do keep that in mind. You're welcome to come to one or two or three, and you're welcome to extend the invitation to others as well. This week is the launch of the St. John's Pop-Up Study Cafe, so we'll be organizing the space on Tuesday for that and then opening the doors Wednesday for a week. Thank you to all who have signed up to be hosts here. I think there's still some spots left in the schedule. And there are postcards at the back. I know our 8 a.m. folks, some of whom go to the gym. They're going to take some to the gym. They're going to take them to the coffee shops. And just anyone who kind of looks student-ish, they're going to hand them out. So follow their example. That's what I have to say. Postcards at the back look like this, and you're welcome to take a few of those with you. Also at the back, there is the Good Boat Christmas hamper, and this is to collect funds that go toward the Interchurch Council Christmas hamper project. St. John's has given a monetary donation as well as lined up a donation of 200 bags of carrots. So the donations that go into the boat at the back, you can, if you're writing a check, make it out to St. John's. That will reimburse some of the funds already spent or add to those which are destined for the Christmas hamper project. Is there anything I missed? Yeah. Great, that's good.
Good morning. I just wanted to mention about our plum puddings. They're famous, and we still have some left from our sale last week. I didn't get a thank you note in the bulletin, but I just want to mention there were 32 people that helped make that project complete, which was wonderful. The mm-hmm. fellowship and the relationships we all share mm-hmm. in the making of the puddings is worth its weight in gold. I also want to acknowledge the businesses that help support the project. Of course, we buy some of the ingredients in bulk, but I approach a lot of businesses. There's 10 usually that contribute, And I just want to make sure that we recognize, I'm not going to name them just now, but certainly local businesses are very supportive of it. So we have puddings in the fridge that are still left. If someone that you know would like to get one, then they're available here. And there's lots of other items set up, I guess, for today until we set up for the study session. So you can do a little shopping after the service. Thank you.
Thanks, Mickey. Okay. Okay, well, our closing hymn today is number 91, People Look East. Let us go forth in peace, for love the Lord is on the way. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
Good to see you folks. How are you keeping?
Good.
Yeah, good. Yes, that's true.